All right, so we're here, day two at the Farm Fest. Right now we're going to a lecture, how to preserve food without canning.
So I want this to be informal. I brought all this stuff and I'll show you a few things. I hope that if you know how to do all this stuff, you don't get bored. I won't feel offended if you're like, I'm gonna go do something else. If you have questions, let me know. I don't have a formal presentation or anything like that. And I would much rather talk to you about stuff than talk at. I work at the university, so I can talk at a lot. That's not so much fun. So, does anybody dry things at home? Okay.
Goji berries.
Goji berries.
Yeah, they're only good dry.
I've actually heard that about goji berries. What about sauerkraut? Do you make sauerkraut? And then, has anybody ever heard, I put this on here because I made this last year. I got this book called Food Preservation Without Freezing and Canning. And there's a lot of stuff in here about preserving things with fermentation and drying and oil. And there was a little chapter on preserving things in alcohol. And so last summer, and I made this stuff called Bachelor's Jam, Officer's Jam, and basically it's one of these things that you can do with stuff that you have left at the end of the season, a few peaches or whatever, and you take fruit, whatever it is, and you layer it in there with sugar, and then you pour rum or some other kind of spirit over it, and you let it sit. As you accumulate stuff, you can make more and more layers until your container is full, as long as you keep alcohol and the sugar content high. So this is an example, I guess, of it's preserving the food, because I then pulled out one of these jars in this past July at a cookout that we had and passed it around, and the peaches were really good, and the berries, blackberries that were in there were really good. Super, it was 80 proof. So it's excellent on ice cream. So I guess that brings me to one thing that I think is a little bit of a myth about home food preservation, right? So I think at its essence, home food preservation is about making food last, so that when you can't grow stuff in the wintertime, you have food that you can eat and you might say, well, I would rather eat cabbage than sauerkraut. I wouldn't say that. I would rather eat sauerkraut than cabbage, but it's the middle of winter and I've got some cabbages in my root cellar maybe. Really, I have these jars of sauerkraut so that I won't go hungry. And one of the things that I think there's some validity to it, that people talk about the health beneficial effects of fermented foods, like sauerkraut, fermented pickles, and stuff like that. And I think there's validity to that. But I think at the end of the day, some of the stuff that we do to preserve foods, with salt, and sugar, and alcohol, you wouldn't necessarily eat that all the time unless you work hard to burn off those calories and drink a lot of water to get rid of that salt, because you can end up in having problems. And I think Bachelor's Jam is the ultimate example of that. There's lots of fruit in there, and you could call it a daily serving of fruit, but it's a lot of rum or whatever. So does anybody have any questions? Is there anything that anybody wants me to talk about in particular? Yeah.
When it comes to drying, do you have any tips for preserving the good stuff, the food, the vitamins, all of those sorts of things?
Yeah. So this is the dryer that I use home. I actually bought this dryer at Target, and it was like $20. And I like it because there's an element in the bottom, like in the bottom of an electric skillet, and there's not a lot of parts to break. I can smash the trays, I suppose. But really, I plug it in and it gets hot and stuff dries. And it does a good job. I dry probably six apples at a time, eight apples at a time. And they never make it through the winter, which I like. I have two kids, 16 and 10, and they both like dried apples. They'll eat three or four apples worth of dried apples, whereas it's hard to get them to eat just one. But so your question, I think that in the important things about drying things and preserving the nutrients and the quality of the fruit or vegetable has to do with a couple of things. One, the quality of the fruit that goes in or vegetables that go in dictate what comes out. So if you're using just your seconds, then what comes out is your seconds. Or if the apples, and some of this is based on experience, sometimes I'm like, oh, I got these apples and they're mealy. They're past and I'm gonna just dry them. Well, the dried apples that come out are mealy dried apples. So that's the first thing. The second thing is with fruit anyway, to use something like this fruit fresh, which is vitamin C, basically. And what that does is if you take a peach and you cut it up and you just heat it up, or you just let it sit, it'll turn brown. It turns brown because there's enzymes in that peach that turn it brown as a defense mechanism against insects. There are things in the peach that react with the air that go from colorless to this sort of brown pigment. And what this vitamin C does in fruit fresh, but you can do the same thing with lemon juice, is it stops those reactions from, especially the chemical reactions from happening. And it protects, vitamin C is an antioxidant, so it protects some of the nutrients that are in the fruit during this processing time. The other thing is, once it's dry, drying is great. Like, of all the things that we can do as humans to preserve food, if you dry something and you keep it dry, it will last forever. Some of the nutrient value of that stuff will go down over time, but I lived in Arizona for a while, and I was visiting an Indian reservation, and we went out and saw these old houses that had been abandoned for 30 or 40 years. And the guy that was showing us around goes over in the corner and he picks up a jar, like one of these blue mason jars, and it's full of tepary beans, which are like a soup bean. And he's like, well, nobody's been in this house in 25 or 30 years. So these beans are from that, whoever lived here. And they were dried and they looked just like a can of beans or jar of beans that you would pull off the shelf. So of all the things that we do, canning, alcohol, salt preservation, all this stuff will, drying keeps the best. Now, so with fruit, you use vitamin C as a way of protecting stuff. With vegetables, what you want to do is parboil things. Same way that you parboil things when you do, or blanch them when you do freezing. And what that does is, it takes that bean or whatever, enzymes that are in there that over time will cause the bean to age and then turn to seed and die. It kills those enzymes. And it protects the nutrients that are in there. Now, you got to be a little bit worried when you boil these things that you usually blanching times are like a minute to 5 minutes, something like that. You start really cooking things down, then all of the, especially the water soluble vitamins that are in there are going to get sucked out into the water. That's why you have that nice green water when you're not boiling.
Steaming
would work. And it would, if you can set it up in such a way that when it steams, it's not sitting in water so much, you'll get a lot less nutrient loss into that water. Other questions?
Does it
tomatoes are like a cusp kind of thing between fruits and vegetables, and most people treat tomatoes like fruit.
Right?
So, like when you can tomatoes like a fruit. They're acid, they have enough acidity to them where you add a little bit of lemon juice to bring up the acidity to it, that it keeps them from it being problematic and you don't have to use a pressure pan. So freezing tomatoes, actually the thing I heard about freezing tomatoes is the closest that you can come to a summer tomato is to freeze a whole tomato in the summer, and then when you get it out, you just let it thaw in a bowl. Taste-wise, texture-wise, it's a little bit weird. So, yeah.
Do you have any tips on drying for people who don't own dryers?
Yes. Okay, so, this is certainly one option, and it will last for a long time. If you have a wood stove or some kind of dry, if the heat in your house is dry, or your house tends to be dry in the winter time, I've dried apples and hot peppers in the air. So the important thing, and the important thing for this, and I guess I should just show you a little bit. The important thing is to make sure that you have a maximum amount of air contact between the thing that you're drying, and the air, so that you get good, and you have good air circulation. And that's true here. So when we put this, these peaches on, this is how they came out. I put these on last night and they dried overnight. But I spaced them in such a way that they didn't touch or overlap or anything like that. So what I do when I dry hot peppers is I take, depending on what kind of hot pepper it is, usually it works best for kind of small things. So I did some little red pepper. I sliced them in half to let the air get lengthwise. So it went from pepper to a pepper that had two legs. To let the air circulate up inside the inside of the pepper. And then I tied them on a string and I hung them up in my son's bedroom because he's got two south-facing windows, and I could hang them from the ceiling. And I just left them. I had about 80% positive outcome. So 80% of the peppers that I put up, and I put up probably 100 peppers. Turned out they dried nicely, they looked good, they tasted hot. 20% that I lost didn't have enough air circulation, and mold started to grow in that white mucilage stuff that inside the pepper. And so that was when I didn't get what I wanted. That's why.
Did you leave a fan running in the room?
I didn't. So when I lived in Arizona, it was great because it's so dry there that we just go. But in our environment, our climate, you can still dry stuff. It works really well if the heat in your house is dry. And so, like, stuff starts to come in, apples are coming in and stuff like that in September, October, if you have a wood stove or something, it's on a little bit. But air circulation is the other thing that's important. You can't dry stuff in a closet someplace because it'll just spoil. There are some really cool designs for solar fruit dryers or fruit and vegetable dryers out there on the internet that involve having an old glass window, a dresser drawer, and a piece of screen. And basically, you match up a window to a dresser drawer, and you bolt that on, you hook that on somewhere else, and then you take the bottom out of the dresser drawer, and you do it the other way first, and you put a piece of screen on there, and then you take the back out of the dresser drawer so that you can slide stuff in and out. Have is glass on top of a wall. out in the sun, there's lots of air circulation through there, and the screen keeps the bugs away from your stuff. It'll get warm, so it'll, if you put it outside and keep it facing south, stuff dries really, really efficiently in those. Another thing that you can do actually is if you have a stove or an oven that's a gas oven, so it has a pilot light on it, a pilot light will generate enough heat that you can dry stuff in your oven. So you put it in there on, we have some perforated pizza pans so that the bottom of the crust gets crispy. You put stuff in there and put it in your oven with the door open a little bit, pilot light heat will dry it. The other thing you can do is if you have an electric oven, you can turn on the heat, heat the oven up, turn off the heat, put your stuff in there with the oven off and the door open, and that, you have to repeat that process a few times, so it's not real efficient, but that'll work too. I actually made beef jerky that way one time, and it worked really, really well. I think another tip for success drying things is to keep your expectations low. I actually think that's an important thing for a lot of this homesteading, home preservation thing. You can build anything. I built a cradle for my daughter when she was born. Built her a lemonade stand. And the biggest, most important thing that I learned was you can build anything as long as you're take your time, and you're willing to overlook the blemishes in the thing that you do. If you get caught up in the idea that I made dried cranberries at home, and this is what they sounded like, and I go to the store and I buy dried cranberries, these are blackberries, but my cranberries sounded like this here. I go to the store and I buy dried cranberries at the store, and they're all soft, and they're chewy, and then you're going to sit those dry cranberries on the shelf and you're going to be like, I'm not going to do anything with those because they're not ocean spray crazies, right? And dried apples, I'll pass this around. These are some peaches that I dried last year. And if you look at my peaches on the bottom, the sugar caramelized and they're all black and kind of ugly, they taste damn good. But if you go, if I took this to Wegmans and I put it on the shelf, I guess if I put sulfite-free, local and organic, people might pick it up. But most people would, I'd be able to watch them go up to it and they go, no, I'll take this. Right? So, that's important. You have to adjust your expectations and decide ahead of time. You gotta have a little self-delusion. You gotta decide ahead of time that the beer that I make is the best beer that I will ever taste. The dried peaches that I make are the best peaches that I will ever taste. And if they're not, I'm not gonna tell anybody. I'm gonna eat them because I hate them. And the worst that'll happen is it'll taste bad. None of this dried vegetables and stuff like that, you won't get sick from it. It'll get mold on it, you'll be mad that it got mold on it and you'll throw it out. Or dried peaches will get, you don't keep them in a, if you don't keep them in an airtight container, they can grow mold. But it's not like you're gonna do this and get botulism, which is a comforting thing. Somebody, yeah. I don't know. I think it might have to do with some of the peaches were more ripe than other ones. This has a gradient of heat from the bottom to the top. So when I fill this up, you know, I'll have five, I think there's five shelves on there. And this on the top. And the one on the bottom always dries the fastest. So what I'll do is I'll put it together in the morning, and then in the afternoon when I come home from work, I take out the bottom one. Put the next one down, and put the bottom one on top. And so that caramelizing, that black color is a heat-dependent process. So those peaches that got the darkest might be the ones that were down here. They're down here just a little bit too long.
Do you recommend this pipeline gather the flash? Do you recommend one of the other, the screw top over that one?
For storing dried things, you can use whatever. If you're going to can, this is the only kind of jar that I can with. These mason jars with this two-piece lid, and these are supposed to be disposable. I have successfully reused these things, and I did that up until the point where I started to lose stuff. Like, I'd come down to my basement in January and realize that one of these jars, the seal had been bad on it, and now I had a jar full of yeasty peaches. And that happened 3 or 4 times, and I was like, forget it. A box of these things is like $1.50. And those peaches, a jar of peaches was $1.50 for the peaches, plus my time and the fact that now I might not make it through the winter with peaches. And I came to that, I really like those jars. I'd really like to can these jars. But when my grandma said, no, I don't can with these jars, when she decided that this was the way to go, like, I'm not going to argue with that.
Right.
She knows what she's talking about.
Do you have any hints on reconstituting the dry stuff?
Typically what I do is soak things in a small amount. So not so much water that I won't use that water in whatever it is that I'm making. So, like, actually for fruits, most of the fruit we just eat dry. And things like green beans and vegetables, where I try to reconstitute them at least part of the way before I put it in whatever it is that it's going in, with a little bit of water so that it will soften up, but not so much water that I end up pouring off water, because I don't want to lose what is going into the water. Yeah. Yes. I think depending. So I dry a lot of oregano and basil and mint, and the way that I do it is, go out and I'll cut. It depends. I shouldn't say that. For oregano and mint, because they proliferate the way that they do, I'll go out and cut a whole stem of oregano, a whole stem of mint, and then I'll cut, you know, bunches of it, especially mint. And then I take those and I tie the ends together with a piece of string, and then I just hang it from the ceiling. So in the wintertime in my house anyway, certain rooms, it's like kind of walking through this forest of dry stuff. For basil, I am a little bit weird with basil in that I pick the leaves off, because I want the plant to keep going. So the only time I'll pick off a stem is if it starts to flower. So I pick off the leaves, and then what I'll do is put those on a cookie sheet in a kind of area where there's airflow. And then every couple times a day, I'll go by and I'll sort of shake things up. You can, according to the manufacturer, dry stuff using one of these things. I think there's two problems with that, and they're related. One problem is that the flavor and the smell of herbs is volatile. So if you heat it up and you walk by and you're like, oh, that smells wonderful. Well, that's all of the smell of your herbs, all those volatile compounds being driven off. So you end up with basil. I've ended up with basil that smells and tastes like grass because all of the basil, those compounds come off. The other thing is, this plastic's pretty good at not holding on to smells, but it does retain odor. So I would much rather dry things the other way and not have my dryer smell like pizza when I try to put peaches or something like that in.
My concern was, does the dirt
Or you could even do, you can take a paper bag. So you've got this bunch of herbs. You can take a paper bag and put your herbs down through it and cut the bottom out of it. And then the paper bag keeps the dust from falling on it. I guess I just eat a lot of dust.
Me too.
Do you ever use the freezer method with herbs?
With herbs? I have a chest freezer in my basement that is packed full. And it's packed full mostly with stuff that I haven't gotten to yet. Like, I pick strawberries, and I'm like, I'm gonna make strawberry jam, but I don't have time, so I put it in my freezer. I actually don't, my wife and I go back and forth about getting rid of the freezer, and I'm like, no, we gotta keep the freezer. I don't actually like to keep stuff in the freezer because I worry that it's gonna quit. And I'm gonna have all this stuff. In the back of my mind, when I do all of this stuff, I have very much this feeling of like, I'm doing this so that I have food in February. Regardless, the world could come to an end and I'm gonna go in my basement and eat pickles and jam and let it all come apart. So I think that, especially for making something like pesto, the freezer method is definitely the way to go. And in terms of preserving the most flavor and having sort of the freshest kind of herb that you can get, putting it in the freezer is your best bet.
I do the ice cubes and this label bag, and you can use them from there. And I roll up.
This is a great thing if you want to make dried apples, because you can make apples that are peeled, cored, and same size pieces. You can help me? You gotta help me. Since you came up here. What's your name?
Booker.
Booker is gonna peel this apple.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Hold on.
All right. Can you turn that crank towards me?
You do that? Okay. Keep going. There it goes. Keep going. It's gonna get harder. All right, hold on. Hold that.
juicing things? We have a steam juicer, which is exceedingly well.
I haven't. I shouldn't say that. I did apple juice last year just by cooking the apples. Like, I chopped the apples up into chunks, took off the stems and the blossom ends, and cooked it in water to get the juice to release. I didn't make jam or jelly, and then I froze it for a can of juice.
Do you make vinegar at all?
I haven't made vinegar. It's on my list of things to do.
It's quite an adventure.
I mean, I think, like, the thing with fermentation, and I learned when the person that taught the sauerkraut course that I took, workshop that I took, he's, like, much more cavalier about fermentation than I am. Because we were talking about making sauerkraut, and he's like, well, I've taken cabbages, and I've just cut them into quarters, and put a whole bunch of salt and brine on them and just let them sit like that, and you get this sort of weird gradient of really sour, you know, really sour in parts of it and not so sour in other parts of it. And I think making, as long as you control the environment a little bit, making fermented things is relatively straightforward. And if you have an attitude that I'm going to taste it, and if it tastes terrible or if it's slimy, and I put that on with the sauerkraut. If you make sauerkraut and your sauerkraut stinks, not like sauerkraut, but like something else, throw it out. Or if it's slimy, throw it out. And start with a small batch if you've never made it before, because one cabbage is pretty cheap, and you can make a fair amount of sauerkraut. And then you can expand from there. You can take turnips, you shred up turnips and pickle them or treat them like sauerkraut, where you mix in salt and stuff like that. You get a really, really tasty Austrian fermented fruit. It's really good. Yeah?
Can we backtrack a little bit about the dryer?
Sure.
I have an Excalibur dryer.
Okay.
And in some of the articles, it says about putting a powder or some type of a chemical on it to retain the color.
Right. The fruit that you're drinking.
Of the fruit. If you're using fruit, or I do dry turnips, and it said also to use something sodium chloride, I don't know what it was. I didn't do that. Will that hurt?
No. So the stuff that I use, and I do add stuff because it's called Fruit Fresh.
Okay.
And it's
made by Ball.
It's made by Ball, and it's basically a mixture of ascorbic acid, which is vitamin C, and citric acid, which comes from citrus fruits.
Okay.
You can. And the a common kind of thing that companies, commercial food dryers will use is sulfite. So you'll see sulfite-free apricots or something like that. And if you put them side by side and look at them, the sulfite-free apricots tend to look like this.
Yeah.
And the sulfited ones are still bright orange and stuff like that. If you don't use something like, and I would say, my colleagues at the university would argue that in terms of relative safety, sulfite-containing foods are just as safe as not sulfite-containing foods. Working with sulfur dioxide is a dangerous thing. And if you add sulfur to your dried fruits the old-fashioned way, which is that you take a little piece of sulfur and you light it on fire and you put it under a box with fruit, it's dangerous because you're making sulfur dioxide. If you have asthma, it'll set off your asthma and stuff like that. I like Fruit Fresh, and or I've even gotten vitamin C tablets. If I didn't PVC tablets and smash them up and mix them in. Because one, you need vitamin C, and two, it's safe to work with. And the other thing is that it's effective. So I soaked these peaches last night in this stuff, and you know, they're not bright orange, but they're not brown either.
And I'm not brown.
I take this and I put a couple of tablespoons of this in a bowl of water. And I soak stuff for, usually cut stuff up into a bowl, like peaches. And my canned peaches, I do the same thing. I'll fill a bowl 2/3 of the way up with water and add a couple of teaspoons of that stuff. And then I'll peel the peaches and I'll slice them right into that bowl. And then they stay orange. They don't brown. And then when I put them in the jar, and then I put another teaspoon of fruit fresh in the jar. I use this stuff like gangbusters. I mean, I don't add it to the point where I don't think it affects the flavor of whatever I'm canning and stuff like that, but I made peaches without it, and they tasted fine. They're just ugly. The other thing is that I do think that having this extra vitamin C there protects some of the other nutrients that are in the food. So I guess to go back to your question, if you dry stuff without that, is it okay? Yeah, it's okay. The food that you produce is still safe food to eat. It might not look as appealing. It might be a little less nutritious in some ways, but hopefully you eat a balanced diet and that sort of stuff works its way out. Right. Yeah.
How long do you soak it? And do you try and dry it off before you put it in the dryer, or just let the dryer take care of it?
I will soak it for as long as it takes. and that's a little bit. So when I do peaches in a couple weeks, we'll do peaches. We'll do a bushel at a time to do can. And so I have some big containers like this. I'll put stuff in all of them. And my wife and I will sit down and we'll peel peaches and we'll put them into this water. And I'll leave at some point and go start a stock pot full of jars. And as I'm doing that, she's still peeling peaches. And so those peaches might be in there anywhere from 5 minutes to a half an hour. I think they say on here about, or in this book, everybody familiar with this book from Ball? If not, the new one, this is an older one, but then get it. Okay, they talk about canning in here, freezing and drying stuff, and it has all of the equipment that you would need. It talks, I like this one especially because it has planning. So for your family of six, if you wanted to have spinach a certain number of times a week, you would have to plant 18. You'd have to plant 90 feet of spinach for the year to have all the spinach that you would want. And then you would collect all that and freeze it or can it or whatever. So I like that part. I think it's fun to think about. It talks a little bit about the science of different stuff, so why certain things have to be handled certain ways, etc., etc. They'll tell you in this book that, well, you shouldn't let them soak for more than X amount of time. I've never noticed a difference. I suppose if you let them soak overnight, you'll get changes in the texture and stuff like that. But I know that this thing will hold 6 or 8 apples. So I'll do this and I'll peel 6 or 8 apples and slice them up and dump them in there. And then let them, once I'm done, I'll take them out and I go over to the sink and I lay my apples out on here and then I set it in the drying or in the dish rack and I let it drip dry until I'm done. And then I'll put it in. And this thing doesn't care. I mean, I guess if you put it into a soup, you'll get a bunch of sticky stuff down at the bottom, but I get on a roll when I have apples. apples, and I want to be able to fill this and dry and fill and dry continuously for a couple weeks. I don't know, until I've done 50 or 100 pounds of apples and do other things. I think an important thing that people don't think about with drying is the fact that almost all fruits and vegetables are 90% water. So when you go to the grocery store, and I did this, I still do this, you go to the grocery store and you're like, what, that tiny little package of is $8? Well, yeah, because that tiny little package represents 25 pounds of fresh blueberries or something like that. So if you have a blueberry bush or raspberries or good strawberries, like dried strawberries, any of those kind of small, expensive things, and you dry them, you have a little gold mine there. You know, you can save a lot of money.
Other advantage too is you save a lot of space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think 50 pounds of apples dries down to about six mason jar quarts packed pretty tight. So, yeah. And I guess I do want to say one thing about preserving. I said this to somebody earlier this morning, that think about preserving in a broader way. Okay, so I put a recipe on there for yogurt. And yogurt is stupid easy to make. I didn't make it for a long time, and then I saw somebody do it, and I kicked myself because of all of the plastic quart containers and sugar and all that stuff that I had gone through. But I can't leave a jar of yogurt out here for the afternoon. It won't be very good. But in terms of preserving, if I put a half gallon of yogurt that I make at home next to the half gallon of milk that I bought at Meyer Dairy, the yogurt will still be safe and edible long after the milk has gone bad. So I think an important thing about preservation is to think about, you know, this is all about not canning, but you can use this stuff in combination with other things. You can use it to keep stuff, you know, you can make sauerkraut and you can put it in your root cellar and it'll keep without refrigeration, without anything, for a year. You can make yogurt, and if you have a cow, I wish I had a cow or a goat. You know, you can keep that. You can keep that milk. This is preservation, right? This is how you preserve sugarcane to get it out of the Caribbean. Whiskey, Pennsylvanians used to make all kinds of whiskey to get corn from over the mountains to Philadelphia and places like that. And then when I make sauerkraut, that's where this long thing's going. I actually make sauerkraut and then I can, because I want to free up the crop that I have to make more sauerkraut, and two, I want to be able to put it on a shelf someplace out of the way and not think about it. And I've gone back and forth with people who said, well, you know, that fermented food is beneficial to you because it's got all these microorganisms, and as soon as you can it, you've killed all of them. Yeah, that's true. But I didn't make that sauerkraut to get those beneficial organisms. I made that sauerkraut because I think sauerkraut's awesome, and I want to eat it, and I want it to last without having to think about it. But that crock is nice because with that lid on there and the water around there, as long as you keep the water on, you know, that seal, it'll keep forever. The only thing that'll happen is if you have a sweet spot for sauerkraut flavor, not too sour, that's a living thing in there, and it's gonna keep doing what it's doing until it can't, basically, until it's created so much lactic acid that those organisms won't grow anymore. And so you might put sauerkraut in January, and you come back in July to eat it, it's gone beyond what you want. So that's
upside or downside or whatever.
Do you make cider?
I do make cider.
Do you make hard cider?
I haven't. I've made beer.
Question?
Oh, I was
cider.
About making cider.
And hard cider.
I haven't made cider. I haven't made hard cider. I made sweet cider, and that came out really well. And I really like. There's really not much better than as juices go, than sweet cider, fresh sweet cider. But. if you can make, if you've made beer, like, or wine, if you've made beer, cider is easier than making beer. And if you want to go into the food producing business, this is an aside, open a cidery. There's like an explosion of cideries going on now, and people are going bonkers to like get locally made hard cider. And it's and the process is very, very similar to making beer, only it's easier, I think, because there's more sugar and the alcohol content goes up high enough that it solves some of the problems.
Right. Well, I stopped eating grains, so I'm moving from beer to cider.
Yeah.
I discovered that I really like cider, the drier. I don't like it real sweet. But
right.
I do like the dryer and wanted to start making that. There is a cider bar, Bushel and Barrel, in Lewisburg now.
Yeah.
And those people make
It's one of those things, like in different colleges around the United States, there's starting to be an emergence of cider making courses, which is kind of a, I think is sort of a late coming harbinger of popularity, because nobody's going to spend the time and effort to come up with one of these courses if they don't think that somebody's going to come take it. So, okay. I think, does anybody else have any really pressing questions?
Just a real quick question. With your yogurt recipe, does it matter if you use pint jars versus quart jars if you're in a slow cooker or something?
No. You can make, and actually, I didn't bring, I should have brought that with me. When mine, this is the jar that I use, this kind of jar. When I put it in a slow cooker, it's only up to about there. So you can use whatever. I think when I make yogurt, I think I eat about a quart to a half gallon of yogurt a week. So I want to make enough that I get through the week and ideally have a little bit left to start the next batch. And if you've ever done, has anybody here ever made yogurt? Okay. Do you use new starter every time or do you slop over to do the thing? Yeah. So there are, science. There are viruses that kill bacteria. They're called phages. And they look like these little lunar landers, and they basically land on the bacteria and inject their DNA into the bacteria and then cause it to rupture and make more phages. If you've ever had the experience where you made yogurt and then you slopped over and made more yogurt, you slopped over and you made more yogurt, and then you did it one time and it didn't work, chances are that you're bacteria, your yogurt had phage in it, and phage killed all of the bacteria. So I've gotten to the point now where about half the time I'll go just buy a container of yogurt that I like the texture of, because it makes a difference. If you buy Yoplait and you like Yoplait texture, you'll get Yoplait-like product. If you like Stonyfield Farms and you like Stonyfield Farm texture, you'll get that kind of product. And, you know, it's a dollar for this, and I can make, it takes 2 tablespoons per quart is what I do to make yogurt. So you can make a lot of yogurt for $1.59, whatever those little things cost. Greek yogurt, if you want to make Greek yogurt, is a different
it's a different thing, and you have to process it in a little bit different way to get it to be really thick and pasty. It's okay if I say that. So you can use whatever container you like. I just picked this one because I eat that much yogurt. Any other questions? Yeah.
Peel your peaches when you try them.
Do I?
Peel them?
Yes. I've made dried apples without peeling them, which this thing is great for that because if you adjust it a different way, it'll core without peeling and slice without that kind of stuff. Peaches, at least in my family, are a divisive thing. Some people like the peel and some people don't like the peel, so I tend to peel them. Actually, I tend to peel pretty much everything except grapes and like plums. I'll turn plums inside out, but I won't peel.
Blueberries.
Yeah. Small fruits. Yeah.
You mentioned plums. How do you do your plums? How do you dry them?
I cut them in half, and usually I'll cut them in half and I spin them, and one half comes off nice and the other half's a pain in the butt.
Right.
So I fish the seed out, and then I put them in here, cut side up, and I'll let them dry for a day till they get a little bit leathery and dried out. And then I'll take them and pop them inside out.
Do you soak them in anything?
Yeah, I do. I tend to soak them as well in vitamin, in that fruit.
My recipe calls for soaking them in honey.
Oh.
Preservative.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't work okay. It made nice fruits, but I just took a while.
I think in terms of the preservation and the food safety aspect of this stuff, with drying, the safety of this stuff is really the fact that it's dry. You know, the bacteria that you might, and with fruit again, it's not, you're not going to get sick eating an old peach. Because the stuff that will make you sick, other than there's some molds out there that might make you sick long term. The stuff that will make you sick, listeria, E. coli, salmonella, won't grow on fruit. Now, I say that, but every bottle of unpasteurized apple cider that's out there says, get this, if you drink this at your own risk because it's not been pasteurized and it might have pathogenic E. coli in it. Well, it had pathogenic E. coli in it because it was contaminated with, the fruit wasn't washed properly and the cider got contaminated with pathogenic E. coli. But all of those things need water in order to grow and divide and stuff like that. So when you dry this down, I would argue adding honey or sugar is more about the flavor of the product and less about the safety of it. Okay, I'm going to be around for most of the day, so if you have other questions, you can come talk to me. I'm going to clean up, and the next person is Garrett Morrison in the back. He's going to talk about growing mushrooms at home. If that's something you're interested in, stick around for that. And they drive one.